Spectate. Woo, what's up, guys? We're here on the B stream. We're going to be casting Orange versus Stan Sifka. We are nearing the end of the day. This is the elimination match for the round, so whoever wins will advance to Saturday, and whoever loses will be eliminated from the tournament. So kind of a high-pressure match for these two guys.
Yep.
I'm so shiny.
This is all in German.
All these lights providing
the heat.
This doesn't
look good.
I think you know where the spectate button is.
I literally don't know what's going on.
We've been doing a bit of partying, so excuse us if the cast is not the most official. What'd you do?
So I clicked buttons. They were in German. So Sifka versus Orange, this is a rematch, right? They played earlier in this group.
I don't remember what the score was.
I believe it was 3-2. I know it was in Orange's favor.
It was close?
It was awesome. It was a great match to watch. There was a game winning uproot. And it took a long time to win after uprooting, right? Like that thing connected for like 20 damage and then traded into a 7-8 and the game just
casual
kept going.
20 damage.
Oh, God, it was so good. It was a beautiful thing.
So we will note that they actually have the same class lineup. Orange is playing Druid Shaman Warlock Warrior, Stan Sifka playing Druid Shaman Warlock Warrior. However, they chose opposite bans. Orange has banned Stan Sifka Shaman and Stan Sifka banned Warrior. So there's still a bit of diversity even though the lineups are the same.
It's particularly interesting since I know Orange was planning to ban Warrior for the most part. Like, you know, he and I have collaborated some. And this is a respect ban out of Shaman, I guess.
It was
changed
the
plans.
Malagos Yogg Shaman, right?
Does it have double Frost Shock? Is that the one?
No, that was... I didn't see the whole list. But okay. I just remember glancing at it, and it was Malagos and Yogg's are on Control Shaman.
I mean, that's a good start to any deck. Malagos and Yogg, there's a lot of overlap synergy there, right? They both want you to play spells. So you just play Malagos, Yogg, bunch of spells. What could go wrong?
But obviously, Orange found that deck to be very troubling. So he decided, this time I'm going to eliminate that. Just try to take on the Warrior.
Yeah, I mean, he managed to beat it, but it was kind of an incredible game where he beat it. Involved, you know... Uprooting Ancient Orange.
So, I mean, it might be a mystery with Stan Sifka's Warriors. I don't imagine we've seen it played. Orange probably knows the player better than we would, and maybe he has a good idea that it's some type of control warrior or something that his lineup's
good against.
I'm thinking
Cthune Warrior. I've seen Sifka playing Cthune Warrior most recently.
And honestly, that's scary for the lineup. Like, if it is Cthune Warrior is good against Shaman and Warlock. So as long as you don't first pick it into Druid, you should be fine.
So here's Sifka's Mark of the Wild Cthune Druid. Versus Orange's Zoo.
Oh, yeah, we see the Mark of the Wild. This is an interesting tech choice. I don't think this was the only druid that was playing Mark of the Wild either. We saw one on the main stage. It was Strifegrow?
I don't know. I mean, it was kind of published from DreamHack Valencia, this list.
Oh, really?
So it's you know gaining mop.
What use it?
I mean, Sifka and people he practiced with. We're all kind of bringing it.
I mean, I kind of like the Mark of the Wild. It gives you a bit of tempo, but generally the disadvantage of Cthune Druid is you run out of cards, so Mark of the Wild doesn't really help that strategy.
Well, there's double Nourish to help you reload if you're out of cards, and double Ash Drake as well. But also, one of the key points is Mark of the Wild is you put it on that 4/10 for 4 mana.
It's hot.
Yeah.
I'm so sweaty right now. Thank God the camera's not on me. These lights.
So we have Lance Carrier and Wrathguard in this zoo list, neither of which he plays in the most mainstream zoos.
Yeah.
Potential brand Lance Carrier synergy. Also, Lance Carrier plays well with the Divine Shieldman, Argent Squire, Argent Horse Rider. I would expect Argent Horse Rider in this list.
They synergize with themselves. Lance Carrier. It's a mouthful, but you
is
get a
that
3-2
a thing?
Out of it. Yeah.
I mean, is a 2-mana 3-2 good? No, right?
Well, it's better than a 1-2, right?
First is that where we're setting the bar?
Well, the first one still gave an attack buff, right? So
okay.
Did something. It's an interesting creature. It's essentially Abusive Sergeant, but the attack buff is permanent, so if you can stick it to a creature for a longer period of time, you get more value.
Something that sticks around with Divine Shield, maybe.
Well, the Horse Rider really... He went for that play pretty fast, but I mean, you have a lot of choices this turn.
Yeah, that's an interesting turn. Brienne had some merit. In order to be cleared, it would involve swiping on turn 5, which is a little bit awkward, and the swipe would not be getting a lot of value. It's kind of a key card against Sue.
And he has the Peddler to get value. Oh, man.
The Peddler and the Lance
Peddler.
Carrier. There was a lot of punish if Brand sticks around. But this way we get guaranteed value off the Brand.
You can't kill the Azdrake if you do that. I think you Lance Carrier the 2-1.
And face?
No, kill the Azdrake.
Okay.
You going to leave spell power? What? Got a chill 6-1 here with the brand Lance Carrier Synergy. I do like seeing, you know, the tech choices in Zoo, right? We see so much standard Zoo. It's fun to have one that plays a little different.
All it takes is one swipe to deal with the brand and the Argent Horse Rider, just like on a previous turn. And swiping on 6 is much better than swiping on 5 because they're more 2-mana plays for Druid than 1-mana plays, especially considering just hero power, although the hero power is not great here.
So he didn't charge any C'Thun buffs yet, which means he does have the option to play double Disciple, and then his 7s are active next turn.
Yeah, but is that really... You kind of have to deal with Bran and the 6-1.
Yeah. Seems solid.
So are we innervating on a Disciple of C'Thun?
Yeah, hero power is not very valuable here. I mean, what does the innervate get for you? Then again, innervate C'Thun will be really strong later.
But will it? Are we going to go... Yeah, I guess on turn 7 we could go double Disciple of C'Thun, turn 8, innervate C'Thun.
I'm pretty sure against Zoo Warlock, even a 6-6 C'Thun is good enough to win the game.
Yeah, yeah.
You just need that little bit of tension on the board, and suddenly the C'Thun makes it happen.
I like it. I like this hero power saving the innervate. So
I got one C'Thun buff from the Twilight Elder.
Flame Embargus is a pretty reasonable way to spend 5 mana. Protect your 1 health minions from a second swipe, a Wrath for 1, or hero power.
Like that. My shield for Argus. 2 health, generally the really awkward value to deal with for Druid.
Yeah, there's Living Roots and Awkward. Keeper of the Grove is kind of gone.
Then again, these Disciples would be nice.
Ooh, the Amber Weaver, that's what it's called. Not so good this turn, but...
This is really solid for Druid.
Does it matter whether you kill the 2-2 Voidwalker or the 2-2 Landscarrier? Can you think of a scenario where it's significantly relevant?
For the healing, the Voidwalker has 1 more health, so if you got Voodoo Witch Doctor, it would gain 1 extra.
Okay. Got him.
If there was Recombobulator still, I suppose the Landscarrier was more threatening.
There we go. 2 drop, yeah.
some value there.
The things we consider.
These are actually the things you think about as a pro player. Yeah. Especially when you're in a tournament setting where you think like, well, one of these is better somehow. What's the actual choice I should make?
Yeah, and so much of the game is kind of automatic because you can practice so much and you know. Yeah. And you just have time then to think about the corner cases.
All right, well, I mean, I think you C'Thun here, right? I think you just win. You C'Thun and
yeah.
C'Thun against you are like absolutely insane.
Now, what are the chances C'Thun goes face 10 times?
Very low. I never have to do that much math. Yeah. Why do you call? Let's see. C'Thun might not actually clear. So there's.
No, it won't, right?
There's exactly 11 health on the board after you trade, which means if C'Thun never hit face, it would clear. You might go taunts with the 2-drop as well.
Yeah. Buffs the C'Thun, although we have a potentially awkward turn 9.
Because C'Thun and those Voidwalkers just seem that great. That's the worst creature.
Feels really bad, yeah. And the taunts are really good here.
Yeah, it's hard to pass.
C'Thun kills a lot of stuff. You could draw, you know, any of a lot of potential removal spells, or C'Thun could just kill the taunts. Yeah, sure.
Seems good. Of course, Warlock has to actually kill that. There's no cheeky way to hex or mulch or anything like that. You just have to do that.
Well,
you
can taunt up and ignore it for as long as possible, but it's going to be hard to push 19 while taunting up every turn.
So one of the things you don't get to see very often is when C'Thun's on the board and you give it a buff, such as with the Vecnor, the onboard C'Thun gains the stats.
Yeah, it's particularly relevant against Paladin. If they Aldor it or Humility or C'Thun down, you buff it right back up to 3 or whatever.
Works with the quality too, I guess.
Yeah.
If it somehow survived.
So nice positioning from Orange's Zoo here. When the Voidwalker dies, the onboard trade, Direwolf Elf is buffing the Flame Imp, but it's just not enough to beat the power of C'Thun with Twin Imps. C'Thun without Twin Imps was probably enough. C'Thun with Twin Imps was definitely enough.
So I don't know what you pick into this. I mean, you have Druid and Warrior. I guess you pick Warrior, right? Because even though it's not a great match, if your best choice is Mirror Match, that feels kind of poor.
Well, it's not going to be exactly a Mirror Match. I'm pretty sure Orange's Druid is a little bit different. So we have Shaman. That seems like it's typically the pick against Druid.
Oh, sorry, Shaman, not Warrior.
Yeah.
Oh, that's
Orange is Warrior's band. It's tricky because they're both playing the same 4 classes. So yeah, Shaman tends to be a good choice against Druid because the totems, can like Flame Tongue and Manatide, could be annoying to deal with as a Druid. Like, the tide draws a card, and then you wrath it, you fall behind by a card.
They don't have much healing either, right?
Right.
So when you start getting that damage in, it's pretty consistent. Though we do see mid-range Shaman from Orange. I'd say normally the aggro Shaman works a bit better here.
So Orange is missing his turn one, and Sifka is not missing much of anything. He's just got, I mean, a perfect...
Good stuff, yeah.
Living Roots into Wild Growth, that's how you want to do it.
I think you might actually mark.
Alright, well, Flame Juggler's got to be the best play you can make there against... Turn
so
one
you're
limits.
Actually skipping Wild Growth? You could play Mark in the Wild and you just pick up a trade. Shaman has a really tough time doing one damage.
Yeah, I like the play. And the Wild Growth doesn't really curve you into anything with this hand, right?
Yeah.
You really just want to play a 3-drop next turn anyways, and we don't have any, you know, 5, 6, 7, whatever.
I have a feeling that Wild Growth's never going to get played now. Like, you play three, and then probably another three. Maybe you could coin Wild Growth and 3-drop on 4.
There's a good chance you coin the Wild Growth on 4. So 1-1 was probably the best totem to roll there because it trades at the 3-1 instead of just giving it a value trade.
Oh, man, it's Wild Growth. But it's such a bait. If you play as the Twilight Elder, then that Mana Tide's going to get... actually, I guess he can kill it anyways. You Rock Biter and trade and Mana Tide. So no matter what Druid looks like, they'll end up behind on board, and maybe the Wild Growths are going to be better. But that gives us the knowledge, like we can see both hands, right? So the decision's much harder for Stan.
Personally, as Druid here, if I'm ignoring everything, I just probably double Wild Growth this turn. And figure the rest out later.
Seems good. So you go up to 6, then you get to play 2 3-drops.
Yeah, so it curves out, sort of. And the thing is, if you don't do the Wild Growths now, they're going to be rotting in your hand until you get to 10 mana and start to awkwardly draw a card off of them. Whereas that Twilight Elder still does something next turn.
You got a lot of big creatures as a druid, too. Like those 6-drops, you can probably just play a 6-drop next
turn. Yeah, makes his top decks much better.
Mantide?
Manatide's pretty good when you have board control. Makes that thing from below cheaper. We waste a mana, but worth. Ooh, Doomhammer, not bad in general. Even better with Rockbiter. Although it's not at its best against a deck full of big taunts, such as C'thun Druid.
Alright, you can double Disciple. That sets you up for later. Wrath.
Wrath Elder sort of trades better on board.
Yeah.
So, Disciple of C'thun is a bit of an awkward card against Shaman. It kills Tuskar Totemic efficiently with 2 damage, but most of the Shaman minions are at 1 and 3 health, so 2 damage is a poor number.
A lot of the time you just end up killing a hero power with it.
Yep.
It plays conservative.
Yeah, I mean, Sifka figures he has a lot of mana, and not a lot of mana to spend in hand, right? His hand is a bit light on things to do, so he squeezes in the hero power.
So, big decision from Shaman. You just start going face. Doomhammer here is kind of nice. You kill a 2-1. You can get that set up. Or you can go, like, Hero Power thing from below is pretty solid.
I definitely like the sound of Doomhammer better between those two plays.
Yeah, me too. Especially with Rockbiter in hand, right? You're already pushing for that late game.
It sets up for the Druid 7-mana turn, which is a 5-10. You can just Rockbiter, take 10, deal with it. It's not the best way to deal with the 5-10, but it's a lot better than not dealing with the 5-10.
I feel like we used to see a lot of Harrison Jones from Druid, but since we've been seeing a more like token and C'thun refined list, they've been cutting those extra cards like Harrison, and suddenly you're vulnerable again.
Yep.
That was a good pickup.
Swipe's going to make this a nice easy board clear. It's just a question of which board clear do we want. Do we want to cycle the Wrath? Do we want to develop the 2-1 Disciple of C'thun? Or do we want to hero power in and preserve both of those options in hand? The answer is cycle the Wrath. I think it's a good answer.
Yeah, it's fair. I mean, the Disciple of C'thun gave you board presence, but...
It would make sense if we needed to buff our C'thun for Twin Imps next turn or something like that, but that's just not what our hand says.
Trog Doomhammer? Oh, he's really holding back on that Doomhammer.
Respect for the Harrison.
I guess he wants to play for the Flame Tech value, because otherwise that's a card that's going to end up useless later when Druid gets control of the board.
Mm-hmm.
It is a mid-range Shaman, right? So that's probably the only Doomhammer in his list.
Yeah. So, Twilight Elder costs 3 mana. And of course, your Disciple of C'thun dealing 2 is awkward as usual.
Yeah. Alright. Well, you want Spell Power Totem into Lightning Storm. Roll high on both. Easy.
Yeah.
It is clear the board. Get
not asking for much.
1/3 and then a 50-50. 2 50-50s.
Doomhammer might be... more consistent. Doomhammer Rockbiter is an option. Yeah, right. Clear the board, push 5 face damage. We don't really care too much that we're taking 8 face damage because the Druid doesn't have a lot of good tools to burst our life total.
Definitely.
Druid needs to stabilize before he can start caring about our life total.
So you're dreaming of a big creature here. You're dreaming of some large taunt that you just get to hex and keep pushing.
Wow, we have Drake Swipe on 9 mana, but it's just not good.
It's still pretty good.
It's okay. It might even be better to, like, swipe Disciple of C'Thun hero power. That's actually a clear. Where Drake Swipe is not.
That's
okay, we're still going for Drake Swipe, sure.
Like, I think that's a good play, even if it didn't draw a card. But when Azurdrake's also getting you a card, you're, like, moving forward in your deck. It's such a good synergy there for Druid. The way, like, Swipe is interacting with spell power is far more beneficial than other mechanics in the game.
Yeah. Yeah, because the spell damage, or the spell power is, yeah, spell damage is applied 4 times, right? Instead of 1 on, like, a normal spell like Wrath.
Well, it doubles the AoE.
Okay.
Think about it. Doubles the AoE damage of Swipe.
Shaman's just back in the driver's seat. And the double nourish in hand is looking pretty awkward here. And the 2 damage from Disciple of C'Thun just not lining up well against those 3 health Shaman minions.
Oh man, I don't know if that's gonna work. I mean, like, yeah, the nourish was... We can see the hand of Hex, right? Nourish is gonna be half to play next turn, then you don't have as much time to use what you drew. Ooh, 2 hexes. My Lightning Storm, just push damage. You get max damage, 10 to face, putting the Druid to 9 and clearing the board.
Yeah, makes sense. Sets up lethal.
You don't get a lot of other Lightning Storms against C'Thun Druid too. It's better against the Token Druid.
Especially with the Druid's hand being depleted at this late point in the game where his hand is likely just big minions.
I guess you're pretty scared of C'Thun.
We have the second X for it. So... fine too. It's awkward, positioning of the Flame Tongue stuck on the left, not buffing too many,
really
just
good.
One.
At the very least, he can survive the turn by killing the Flame Tongue with the Wrath.
Twilight Elder fills out the curve. Everybody gives us more options.
Ooh.
Do we want some 4/6s?
I mean, you're definitely scared here, right?
Let's see. So saving the storm looks pretty good if Twin Imps ever shows up. But anyways, so the Flame Tongue plus the Doomhammer can deal with Twin Imps here. I might still go for Wrath the Flame Tongue and Twilight Elder. You could even innervate Hero Power, but if you innervate Hero Power, you can't Twin Imps innervate Nourish next turn. But like, you don't really want to Nourish anyways.
Yeah.
You want a Twin Imps and play your top deck.
I like the Hero Power.
Yeah.
Time waits for no one.
It also makes it so the Twilight Elders can kill a wolf for free.
Well, it still ends up getting picked off by a Doomhammer or a Blinding Storm or whatever, but yeah. It's just a good use of your cards. Clear as much of that stuff as we can.
Looks like he's not going to play it.
Oh, wow.
Alright. That's definitely takes some balls to not clear or not like play out your stuff when you got 12 health.
Yeah. It's a very patient play from Zivka.
You have to be hazarding, I guess, of what's in his hand at this point if you didn't play anything that turn.
14 mana. Oh. I remember the first time I had 10 mana in Innervate, didn't know you could not go above 10 mana.
Yep.
That was a bad feeling when I innervated from 10 mana to 10.
We've all done that.
Yeah.
Especially
everyone does it once,
druid,
right?
And
then you're like...
combo druid, and you have double combo, and you think, wow, just innervate double
yeah,
combo.
Yeah, got him!
Oh,
ooh.
No.
That was a mistake.
Okay.
Well, the Lightning Storm got better.
You got a 50-50.
So Orange's patience on that Lightning...
Too.
Orange's patience on that Lightning Storm is getting rewarded here. We had an opportunity to play it a few turns ago. We thought maybe should have.
Ooh. Okay. You Hex 1, a Lightning Storm. You're putting...
Do you Hex 1?
7 damage through.
Okay. We do.
So you 3 damage off.
0 mana is a good price for a 5/5 taunt. I feel like that's worth it.
Did you see the seat out there? The card they have for Need for Seat?
No, what do they have?
0 mana 10/10.
Yeah.
I asked if they could put that in my deck for me.
What did they say?
They said no.
Unlucky.
Yeah. Guess I gotta be the sponsor. Hmm. You know he has nothing. Are you dead anyways?
Yeah. Looks pretty dead to me.
No, if you hear one off. One inch. Yep.
Alright, technically not dead. The best kind of alive.
I mean, hey, you draw C'Thun. Still, what's that C'Thun at?
Big.
21 C'Thun. I think you don't die here, you draw C'Thun, you win the game.
Alright, step one, don't die. Achieved.
Didn't die.
Use some awkward trades into a 5-7.
There's no way you use the weapon. You're so low with 11.
I mean, going from 11 to 6... Could die to two card combinations, but it's unlikely that the druid has those kinds of damage cards because he had a lot of good opportunities to use those because you've had board control for so many turns.
Right. How many cards left? Druid's got a pretty high chance to get C'Thun. Six cards. I'm giving him a 1-6 to win. It's not bad considering how the game went down. Oh, he takes the face.
I think it's fine. I think you want that extra board presence so that you can try and push through for lethal next turn. This game went up pretty close.
Alright, 1-6.
I like going face there since the Beckoner of Evil doesn't really trade into anything very effectively. Like, killing the Taunt Totem, who cares? That's lethal.
1-7 now, I guess.
Yeah. And Sifka agrees, that's worth it.
Has to go face.
Hero powering. Ooh.
That tense moment there.
Well, it was lethal. Just, you know, not for the active player.
Yeah. Needed a stronger play.
That was a satisfying game. Came down to a nice, you know,
yeah,
they were outs
close.
The whole way through.
I mean, the Ragnaros and C'Thun being at the bottom, I think you'd be kind of sad about that. There were turns he was floating mana where he didn't have things to play
right
after the nourishes and... Yeah, it just didn't develop the board, right?
Yeah, the Druid deck did lose despite having a very strong opening, but it's also a fairly unfavorable matchup, and there were some awkward turns, as you mentioned.
Yeah. Honestly, when he played Twin Imps, I thought he was going to win, right? When he got that Twin Imps down and he had double Innervate, it seemed like he had a good chance there, but it didn't work out.
He certainly had a chance. I didn't feel like he was favored at the moment, I don't think.
Picks Warlock. So it's mid-range Shaman. Typically, Warlock's very favored against aggro, but mid-range Shaman with Lightning Storm certainly holds up well.
I think you're still favored as Zoo. It's easier to win the board in the early game. Mid-range Shaman has more of those big clunky cards like Thunderbluff Valiant that they can draw and just create bad turns for them because they don't have the cards they need. They don't have as many cards like Lightning Bolt to deal with this Flame Imp.
Boy, this is a really good start for Zoo.
It's a really good start for Shaman, too.
Yeah, fair game. I guess you play the Squire first, right? You're not
yeah,
gonna overload.
The synergy with the Flame Tongue is just immense.
The light protects. Normally you'd say these matchups come down a lot to the early game, but Shaman's actually in the lead and has the backup plan with Lightning Storm already. So it's going to be pretty tough for
yeah
Zoo to take over.
If Zoo falls behind, they can... I mean, this early, when they're this not that behind, you can recover with something like an Imp Gang boss. Knife Juggler gives him some chances. Forbidden Ritual is sort of the standard recovery card for Zoo these days. So here...
Councilman?
Yeah, and we're just going to try and isolate that Flame Tongue Totem. Hopefully we can get a value trade on it later to get that tempo.
Yeah. Tuskar Totemic into Totem Golem. I haven't seen any good Tuskar Totemics today, so somebody's due for a good one in here.
Yeah, I think mine bricked. I think my Shaman was 0-2.
Yeah, I saw a lot of just normal totems.
Yeah.
And, yeah, that was a good one.
Oh, yeah. Two Flame Tongues next to each other are... they're good friends. Because Flame Tongue has this immense weakness in that it has zero attacks. So you can just value trade into it, right? But once it has two attacks, it's a lot harder.
And you have to kill it. Right?
Yeah.
It's not like you can ignore that creature.
It's not very friendly, yeah.
All right.
We could Juggler Peddler. We don't need the abusive buff.
Like
do we
peddler
need the juggle?
First.
What if? Yeah. What if we Peddler one drop abusive, right? Or just Peddler one drop?
Yeah.
The juggle doesn't do a whole lot on this board, because you're only getting one juggle and there's nothing with one health and yeah.
Compared to like a Soulfire. Soulfire would be huge here. You could take out one
yeah
of them and then still develop your board.
It would prevent your councilman from taking damage while trading. You'd clear both Flame Tongues so that he wouldn't have an onboard answer to your councilman. Bye.
And the verdict is Corruption, Flame, and Power. Those are still pretty good cards, but not quite what he wanted.
Flame Imp is that board presence he's looking for. Trade into the 2-3 Flame Tongue.
Oh man, this Lightning Storm. That shot Lightning Storm. Roll high on the council, man. You win the game. Actually, you don't even need to, right? You can still trade Tuskar at worst.
Yeah, I mean, probably winning either way here. It's looking good for Orange. Trog Lightning Storm is just kind of gross. Like, you get a 3-3.
You got it.
For one man. Oh, wow.
And that was disgusting. The worst top deck after your board got cleared.
Yeah. We needed the Forbidden Ritual there. Knife Juggler Forbidden Ritual was the play. Struggle's not going to get it done.
I mean, Shaman just goes face. Well, I can't tap anymore, so it's pretty much over.
Yeah. Feral Spirits is not the worst card to draw this turn either.
Oh, he's trading.
That's interesting. I mean, it also wins, right? So it's not
it's
wrong.
Hard to lose.
Kind of have your choice of how to win. There's no Argus with Sea Giant play here.
So it's going to come down to Stan Sipka's Warrior, and in the first time they faced, Orange banned the Warrior, and he ended up winning the series.
Mm-hmm.
So this time the Mysterious Warrior deck has to change it around, and I wonder if Orange will kick himself a little if that happens, since you know he did change his ban.
Right. Last time I saw Sipka playing a Warrior, it was a C'Thun Warrior with one Revenge, one Emperor, no Doom Caller, no Bran. So it was
C'Thun Warrior with no Bran?
Yeah, no Brand, no Doomcaller, but it did have Emperor. So it was pretty interesting. It was kind of out there compared to other lists I'd seen, which is kind of what you would expect from Sifka. The guy he puts a lot of work into Hearthstone and analyzes things and comes to his own conclusions as to what's correct and what's optimal.
One of the things I'm interested in, when I played Sifka in Valencia, and his star deck to me was his rogue deck. He was just crushing people with that, but he didn't bring it to this one, and I wonder why.
Well, maybe it's his fifth deck. Maybe we'll see it in the top eight.
Yeah, maybe. He was doing really well with that rogue deck in Valencia.
Strong opening hands from both players. So who do you think's favored when both players are drawing well?
I actually don't know this. Oh. I don't know this combo warrior that well.
Yeah. So it is definitely not C'Thun Warrior. This Rampage tells us it's a Raging Worgen Warrior, which
I've heard good things about this.
Yeah, I played a few games with it, and it was, first of all, it was a lot of fun. You get to make a lot of decisions. It feels a little bit like the old Patron before Warsong Commander got nerfed. It's not as complicated or, I would say, challenging or fun as that deck, but it's you know, the closest thing we get these days. And Blood Dicker on Argent Squire feels good. Even when you waste two out of your first three mana, it feels good.
I wonder, he could have gone for Wolves this turn. I need a Squire to follow up. The Wolves would trade well on the 2-2. The Rockbiter's a nice face damage later.
That's a bad draw for Sifka. It's one of those funny things where you need the Raging Worgen to win the game, but you do not want it early because you're not trying to win anytime early. What you want early is just ways to draw cards and clear the board, get you to that late game where you've survived everything and you eventually kill him.
Yep. And from what I've seen, these lists only run the one Raging Worgen, so there's no chance to play it out.
Yeah, you have to hold it. Rampage is not quite in the same boat. It can be used for the combo, but you don't need actually that extra +3/+3 to win the game, so you can just use the Rampage for value on a random Acolyte of Pain or whatever survives, most often a Pyromancer, I suppose.
So you could have Acolyted instead of Ravaging Ghoul last turn. He had both Squires on the board. I mean, Flame Tongue would have traded on the Acolyte, I guess, but now he's stuck with an Acolyte that doesn't trade well.
You might have to just shield block this turn and try and hope to find some kind of Pyromancer turn a couple turns away. One thing you want to do with this Raging Worgen Warrior, a game-winning play, is something like Pyromancer, Commanding Shout, Battle Rage. And you basically whirlwind twice while drawing multiple cards. It's really disgusting. You add a Blood to Ichor in there, it deals even more damage to their board, draws an extra card off the Battle Rage as well. It's pretty disgusting when you can set up those swing turns. So these weak looking turns from Sifka are not they don't spell death like they would with a non combo deck.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, he needs that pyro for sure, but he's got a bit of time to do it still.
Yeah, he's got Loot Hoarder, Slam, Acolyte, plenty of cycle to look for, right? just needs to believe. So Tunnel Trog, Feral Spirits, that puts a lot of power on the board. Seven power. Yeah, seven
Shaman,
attack, rather.
Shaman's going ham right now, right?
Yeah.
Like, you consider some other Flame Juggler totem, but realistically, you want to kill him as fast as you can before he gets those pieces.
Yeah, before he gets to those Pyromancer turns.
Acolyte Loot Hoarder, max draw, or you take some damage away with the slam.
You could slam your own Acolyte. That's a way to guarantee multiple draws off the Acolyte.
Yep.
And indeed, that's what he's going for. He's just looking to draw as many cards as possible, as fast as possible, so he can get to those sweet Pyromancer turns and win the game.
Oh, Fireworks.
Yeah, Fireworks is normally very good against Shaman because all those three health minions, Feral Spirits in particular, also Tunnel Trog. In this case, the Shaman has so much stuff on board that dealing with one thing a turn may not be that helpful. It might be sort of an all or nothing kind of scenario where you really need to just find the Pyromancer or die trying.
You could do a pretty good pyro if you try it. You wouldn't quite kill the wolves, but you'd clear the rest of the board.
Oh, now, nice. Slam Ravaging Ghoul seems worthwhile. We're killing the Tunnel Trog and the 1-1 and developing a 3-3 to contest those Feral Spirits.
That's funny to say that Warax is
there's the Pyromancer.
Slow. Okay. So this gets
not for this
really
turn.
Cool
it's
now.
For next turn. This turn's just Ravaging Ghoul.
Your spells to activate it are kind of poor.
Yeah, we don't have the commanding shout, but don't worry, that's what the top of our deck is for.
You could do
we've got it right where we need
it. Alive.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah, Pyromancer into Battle Rage into Rampage. That's six, and then we have one mana left, so we don't get anything too sweet after that. Probably
and
execute after that.
Yeah, you even have enough mana to execute if you trade.
We're going to want to.
But if he doesn't get it, he's down to... Oh!
Hey.
Wow. This is a little awkward, because you do still have to cast three spells, even though you only need to cast two, since you can't Rampage.
I'm going to go ahead and say worth, because at the end of this whole series of events, we have like a board and a hand, and the Shaman has no board and a much smaller hand.
Yeah, that executes.
It's going to be really tough for Shaman to come up with 15
damage.
Oh,
wow. Doesn't even have to use Rampage.
Yeah, Commanding Shout's just better, right? I don't know if it's just better.
I have not played this deck personally. I think both of them are great plays.
Yeah, they're both good. I think that's a good answer. Yeah, wow. This look at Orange's face. Oof. Right now. Very little reaction. A true professional. He knew this was a possibility. He's mentally prepared for it. Doesn't faze him.
We're
on to the next
really low
thing.
And this warrior deck only has shield block for armor gain. There's no armor smiths or anything as far as I know. So
yeah, just shield block and the hero power, that's it.
Had you had a Doomhammer this turn, I think you could be pushing pretty well to actually win.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, the thing from below is sort of a thing here. We don't have a good answer to it for Sifka. Health total is low enough that...
This is going to get pretty funny if he plays Thorzan, where I think you just ignore Thorzan and go face. But it's so rare you can ignore Thorzan on the board. It's
right.
Just there's no way you're going to value trade.
Do you think it's Emperor and gain 2? 17?
Yeah. Oh, the greed.
He's going for the Loot Hoarder.
There's,
It doesn't gain life, but it helps him to potentially clear a bigger board the following turn.
11
so it's
on board. Doomhammer would be lethal.
One thing is playing the... Well... So, we have mana to do everything, so we start by toteming to see what that does.
I'm curious, Kit, how much damage would, like, be a possible draw? You need the charge still, I guess. There's no way to do damage until you have charge.
I can't think of a reason to not Storm. Like, Storm is so bad in this matchup. The Warrior has very little board presence, right?
Are you even trading, though? I think you just go face. I think
yeah,
you
you're saying even when we roll three on the Emperor, our Flame Juggler's not going into the Emperor to clear it. We're just going face for four with our Flame Tongue.
So you're storming for Loot Hoarder. Value. Storm for a one health card draw.
Wow.
But he's... yeah, I mean, I think you're right. There's nothing else to storm, right? He won't play creatures.
You could trade into Emperor.
I don't know.
Oh, yeah, it doesn't matter whether you high roll, you have the Flame Tongue. Okay.
To the face. Oh, makes the trade.
I'm fine with this. It protects your
okay.
It protects your thing from below from dying. So now we have the Worgen charge part of the combo. We're missing some other pieces. Something like an Inner Rage and a way to get past the taunt.
Yeah, Inner Rage. I don't know, man. Warrior might be dead.
Yeah. Even though he hit that Pyromancer combo.
Right on time. With the execute. Like, that was the dream.
Yeah.
No Doomhammer.
It's not quite as lucky as it sounds in that scenario because this deck just draws so many cards. And
I'm down with this. He got Commanding Shout. He actually gets a full clear here.
Yeah, well, it's better than dying, right?
Yeah, for sure. And the Worgen lives. So you have a threat that could potentially kill him next turn.
It'd better kill him, because if that dies, we're not going to win very often.
Okay, having not played charge much, the charge damage is permanent. So
yeah, yeah.
So if he is the charge permanent, so say you drew Faceless, would your Faceless continue to have charge?
Yeah, I believe so.
Cool.
I think charge is like always permanent. Like if you Warsong Commander Grim Patron and the Warsong Commander dies, and they later like MC Tech your Patron, it still has charge.
That's true, and Grommash still has charge, so cool.
Oh my god,
oh, the juggle.
So much esports right now.
Wow.
All right, Orange, I don't know what you're thinking, but I'm thinking I'd hit the sixth one with that juggle. Ooh. That got a reaction out of him. That got a reaction. He didn't like that too much.
Where's this Doomhammer at? Shaman has
so this
still
is,
17 cards.
Is this lethal?
Yeah,
go to 9 plus another 4. It's 13, 26, 29 for sure.
That's a lot of damage.
Oh, he doesn't want 29? All right, he's not thinking about the memes. That's fair, Sifka. You're just here to win. That's fine. I don't blame you. I wonder about this matchup. I wonder if there's any way... I wonder if there's scenarios where Shaman can take it long because Shaman has so many taunts. There's the Taunt Totem, Thing from Below, Feral Spirits. And if you just put a taunt in the way of a Raging Worgen, it's, you know, a way to just beat that deck.
So I think the C'Thun Druid... Well, at least have a good shot at that, right? The
yeah.
things like the 4/6 taunts, those
yeah.
are horrible to kill. The 5/7 taunts.
Yep.
You can stack up a bit.
The 5/10 taunt, maybe.
And then C'Thun itself will probably kill the warrior because they never heal.
Yeah.
I think this is probably the matchup you would want to take. If they were to pick warrior, you'd think I'll take the druid into that. So.
Look at this wild growth innervate chosen hand. It's hard to ask for much better than that.
Well, that's not even good, right? Because it's off curve one.
Well, I'm just not using the Innervate, personally. I'm going Wild Growth into Chosen, and I'll yeah. Innervate something.
That seems good.
That
oh,
one.
Yeah. There
probably
we
that
go.
One. There's our curve.
Wow. I mean, Warrior Sand's not bad. You got cards
yeah.
out early. You got some Pyromancers with Commanding Shout.
Yeah. The Pyromancer's a turn 6 play, typically, in this Warrior deck. But it's so important to have. Well, I guess maybe you don't want it in the opening hand against Druid.
Coin Acolyte.
Coin is a pyro activator. It
yeah.
gets you to big pyro combo turns a turn sooner.
You can just play pyro. You don't need to. I have no idea.
Right?
He's
you could also. Yeah, I mean, I'm struggling with this turn as well. This is complicated. You just armor pass. That's my first instinct. But you have to think. What is Druid turn 4? It's C'Thun's Chosen, right? So is there a logical play to set up for that? Coin Acolyte doesn't really set up for that.
No. Coin Acolyte, you can Commanding Shout next turn and trade the Acolyte and get an extra draw.
So if we play Pyromancer, he plays C'Thun's Chosen, and we go Acolyte, Coin, Trade. That's pretty solid. So maybe Pyromancer's the play. Although playing a naked Pyromancer feels really bad.
Yeah.
Like.
Okay.
Like, you would never consider it if you didn't have two in hand. And when you do have two in hand, it's still like,
I think Orange is loving that pass.
Wow, look at this hand from Orange. This is ridiculous.
Yeah.
He's going Chosen into Innervate 5/10, or maybe 10/5, because it's just dying to execute or winning, right? Maybe
he wins with another 10/5.
Can he please uproot two matches in a row against Sifka to knock him out of the tournament?
This is the match for it, right? Like,
yeah, this looks like you're not dealing... Slam War Axe, you're going to face tank 10? I'm thinking of ways to deal 5. It's, I mean, Pyromancer, Slam, Ichor, that's 5, isn't it?
So I would note, we have a kind of strange C'Thun build from Orange. Normally you just see the consistent C'Thun cards, whereas Orange has included like Fandral and
mm-hmm.
a bunch of other Druid spells. Normally
Fandral, Raven Idol, Ancient of War, yeah. So it's less C'Thun focused.
Maybe he cuts the 2 drops.
The C'Thun Enabler 2 drop?
Yeah,
and he also doesn't play the 4/10 at 4 mana. Right, if you're not playing the 2 drop. So there's no Beckoner and no Amber Weaver. Wow, I remember the names. God, I'm great. Okay. Shield Block Pass, yeah. I mean, that's kind of.
It's the combo turn now.
This is one of the things I love about combo decks. It's not like every turn is just, okay, what's the play that leaves me with the strongest board presence? You actually get to do these patient setup plays where you think a few turns in advance. Yeah. I mean, okay, there's thinking a few turns in advance with every deck. But with this deck, there's patient plays.
Baby, let's more see so. This.
Fandral Raven Idol. Okay, so you can look for choose ones in particular in case your Fandral somehow survives.
Those are good creatures. We see Klaxi Amberweaver, which obviously gives a Cthune synergy. Archmage, which is a 6 mana, pretty poor creature. And Yashara. Yashara
costs 10.
The old god that rarely sees play, but I mean, hey, if you get it out of Raven Idol, it's not so bad.
I mean, I think the 4 mana 4 or 5 is just...
Yeah.
It's the pressure play. It's the thing you can do.
And another
Raven Idol. We're going infinite. Oh. You could innervate that. I don't think you want to. By the way, I want to mention... Until Orange drew C'Thun that turn, I think he was going to innervate out the Ancient of War.
Yep.
But once you draw the C'Thun, then you start thinking, okay, maybe I Fandral Raven Idol this turn. Maybe I think about innervating C'Thun on 8 mana.
Though I think now he has another Raven Idol. He'll still go innervate Ancient War with Raven Idol.
Mm-hmm. You'd Raven Idol first, see what you hit. If you don't like your turn, then you innervate the Ancient of War. But
so I'm looking at the Druid plays, and I'm already thinking there's a lot of choices. But to consider the Warrior plays brings a whole other level to it.
Yeah.
We've seen him pass two turns, and now things are starting to happen.
He was looking for the War Axe with that slam, but he didn't get there.
Oh, wow. War Axe would have dealt with the Fandral.
Yeah. I mean, it feels bad, but these are the tough decisions you have to make. Look at Sifka's face. You can tell he's thinking hard.
C'Thun's only at 8, not active, so...
Raven Idol created by Raven Idol. Feels good, man.
Another 10 mana 10-10. This one doesn't do anything, though.
There's a 3 mana 5-5.
Oh, yeah, you have Fandral on board.
Yeah, probably Innervate.
Yeah, Innervate looks good. Oh, I love that glow that you get off.
I might make a 5-5 and a 4-5 here.
The 10-10.
Okay, yeah, 10-10's big, but there's the question of execute, right? We haven't seen an execute yet. Maybe Orange is making the read that because Fandral stuck around for a turn, he doesn't have execute. But I think that's sort of a questionable read. It's like a soft read, not a guarantee, because you actually could leave Fandral alive to save execute. Execute's like extremely critical for the combo warrior to beat this druid, because you have to be able to get through the taunts or you just lose. Like, you just have the one Raging Organ, and it has to kill him. Yeah. It has to be able to connect past taunts.
Yeah, you need to get rid of all the taunts. War Axe, one turn late here.
Unlucky.
I mean, I guess you clear, right? You do Pyromancer for 3 damage, Commanding Shed, like Coin Ichor, but you're not going to kill the 10-10. That's just a giant chunk.
Are we keeping our Loot Hoarder on board, or are we drawing a card off of it? Drawing a card off of it. Execute,
you get one more chance.
Yeah. No. So we can do something like Ichor, Coin, Ichor.
Just Ichor, Coin.
Just Ichor, Coin. You don't want the second Ichor for just damage on that 10-7.
Kills the first one, right?
No, you got Commanding Shout up. None of your stuff's going to die this turn.
True.
Get a 2-1.
So, all of the C'Thun stuff looks good in hand, but it's only an 8-8 right now, so nothing's activated. Which means the next turn can be pretty awkward.
This game looks fairly impossible for Sifka to win, considering
I don't know,
of the taunts and pressure on Orange's side of the board.
That's like, good.
The 10-5 sticking to the board is a good indicator of what's going on in the matchup, but even if Sifka finds an execute for that, there's more taunts to come, and taunts just win. They don't even have to kill you.
Good.
And 2 mana, kill your 6-3 Pyromancer seems pretty efficient. 4 mana 4-5 is about the same as a 4 mana 4-10. Really doesn't matter.
With C'Thun. Oh, off the top, the saving grace.
But is it a saving grace? It just gets to keep kicking, I think.
You can play Pyro, Acolyte, Execute, draw a card.
Sure. Do you want to be greedier than that with the Pyro? Maybe not, because you
is
have
there any way to clear? Not really, right? It's got too much health. Execute, double Ichor, War Axe. There you go, you clear the board. It's kind of weird not to use the Pyro or the Acolyte, though, because you really need more cards.
Yeah.
I think you probably want to drop Thorzan or something, but you're dead.
No,
so
you can't. Yeah. You can't. I liked your first thought of Pyro, Acolyte, Ichor.
Pyro, Acolyte, Execute.
Yeah, sorry.
So Katoon's at 8. Which means if Acolyte's on board, he can't really play it. He might just end up playing 7 mana as a 4-6.
Yeah, as often happens when you play Hearthstone as much as we do, first thought tends to be a pretty good one.
It's like every card he draws is more card draw. It's just the way the deck is built. Every card is more card draw.
It's a Magic player's dream. Magic players love drawing cards. I don't think Hearthstone players are that different. Although, like Hearthstone, it's just more of a tempo game. Yeah, Cthulhu's right here.
Set up for lethal with Druid of the Claw, I guess.
Pushes a lot of damage.
Is that it?
I mean, you could Acolyte Ichor, draw, execute. Ichor is Cthulhu, execute it.
Even then, you're dead. Druid of the Claw charge with a 4-3.
Yeah.
Something mysterious has to happen that I don't see right now for Stancifica to survive.
Nah, nothing mysterious is going to happen. He just doesn't get to see Orange's hand and doesn't have the benefit of knowing he's already dead.
Yeah. I mean, so he's clean play by the Druid, right? I do think the Druid's probably one of the best matchups for taking out this deck.
Yeah. And also, he had one of the best draws you could imagine.
Yeah.
Like,
what was it? Wild Growth, 4 drop.
Yeah.
Raven Idol.
Yeah.
Into another Raven Idol.
Right.
Into a big taunt with Fandral on board.
Like, he even hit the Cthulhu minion off of his Raven Idol, which didn't matter at all, but it was a nice little touch, little rub in.
Well played. Good series.
Yeah.
Came down right to the end.
So Orange single-handedly knocks Sifka out of this tournament, just 2-0s him in groups. Feels bad. I've been there before, getting 2-0'd by the same person. I think Hyped did it to me once. Can't remember which tournament.
Well played. I liked Orange Cthulhu Druid with more spells.
Mm-hmm.
It seemed like it had more flexibility, right? As soon as we saw Fandral come into play, there was like things opening up there. Whereas normally the Druid's like, play your dudes and hope they work.
Right.
And if they don't work, you're screwed. But when you have those like flexible things, you can make special stuff happen.
Right, so Druid's very focused on just playing big dumb minions, which can be kind of exploitable. It's easy to play big, not entirely mentally challenged minions. War. Yeah, slightly. Okay, so big minions, which are kind of predictable and therefore exploitable by a smart opponent. But then once you play Raven Idol, all of a sudden you're discovering spells and anything can happen. And
even just matching up against him, if you know he's playing that, then you're not as confident going against that with some of your counter decks because he could get things you don't see coming.
Yeah, anything could happen.
Yeah, I mean, well played. I liked watching that. That was a good series. Hope you guys enjoyed it, too.
And
I think that wraps it up for us.